that I say hallelujah. Glad to see you all in this new year. None of us did anything to deserve to be here. It's all because of his grace and his great mercy to us. If you would, I know in your worship guide you have Acts 1:8, but we will also, I will read first Matthew 28, 18 through 20. Before we get there, I just want to put a couple of things before you. All of us are paying attention to the news. All of us are. And we see that this new variant is wreaking havoc in our world. My wife and I just had to cancel a trip because of it. So I just want to remind us of these things. We are still in the midst of a pandemic. And so let's be aware as we are in people's space, because this variant seems to be highly transmissible, maybe more than the others. And so just be cognizant of people's space, even as we come to worship. Y'all know me, I'm the dude that's going to hug you off top. But I have to remind myself that I need to probably push back on that, because I want you to be safe. And so just be aware of what we did in the beginning, social distancing and masks. All of us, we do have masks for worshiping here, and you all are wearing them. But let's keep that in mind and continue to pray to the Lord that he would relieve us of this pandemic, because he is still ruling. The second thing I want to point us to, I'm going to start doing this at this point in the service, just reminding us of giving. We our normal ways of giving, most of us give online, so you can continue to do that. And if you want to give in person, we have boxes that are available for you to give. Today we are beginning a new series on disciple making. That's one of our values. In the fall, we looked at our value of the gospel. And I want to mention this, because we do have these values, but what are the aims? Why do we have the values we have? So, well, first value was one of the gospel, and we walked through the gospel looking at Jesus's I am statements. The reason we have this as a value, our aim is for our people is to be fluent in the gospel, or another way of saying that is having gospel fluency. We desire for every person who calls reconciliation home in worship that you could go out and meet anyone and be able to share the gospel with them, knowing the gospel. So we have that as a value. Today, we're going to begin looking at our value of disciple making. Why do we have that value? Because our aim is that every one of us would be committed to reproduction spiritually. We want to invest our lives into the lives of others and see them repeat the process of investing in the lives of others. This is what Paul said to Timothy in 2 Timothy 2:2. He said, "The things you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to faithful men or faithful people who would be able to teach others also." And so for the next few weeks through the month of January, we are going to look at this value of disciple making. And I want to read now Matthew 28. Verses 18 to 20, and then Acts 1:8. In Matthew it says, "Jesus came near and said to them, 'All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age.'" And in Acts 1:8, Jesus says this, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come on you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." This is God's word. John Sculley, he was the CEO of Pepsi when he received a call from a co-founder of the behemoth Apple, Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs was looking for a CEO for this new upstart. He interviewed about 20 people, but he was not pleased with them. And so he contacted John Sculley and he interviewed him. 5 months later, Steve Jobs offered John Sculley the job, but John Sculley initially turned it down. But Steve Jobs would not accept no for an answer, so he scheduled some more time to get with John Sculley. And in this meeting, he made a statement that many know that would change the trajectory of Sculley's life. He said these words: "Do you want to sell sugar water for the rest of your life? Or do you want to come with me and change the world?" Most of us in here have Apple iPhones and other products. Sculley was on the top side of that. Steve Jobs asked him, "Do you want to sell sugar water for the rest of your life, or do you want to come with me and change the world?" God, in his infinite wisdom, uses you and I to be conduits or change agents in the world. When Jesus came to earth, he could have came and said, "I'm going to focus on changing systems." He didn't come changing systems. He could have come and set up a new rubric on earth that, apart from what he wanted to do to impact the world. But he didn't come doing it that way. He came to change the world by using people like you and I. And he has given us a mandate to impact the entire world. He calls us to make disciples. But what does it mean to make disciples? Here is a definition that we're going to work from. I don't have a slide for this, but I'm going to repeat it twice. This is the definition that we will use as we are in this series. Disciple making is our capacity to lovingly embody the person and work of Jesus Christ and transfer him into the lives of others. I'm going to repeat that. Disciple making is our capacity to lovingly embody the person and work of Jesus Christ, and to transfer him into the lives of others. In order to accomplish this, God's vision for the world must be our vision for the world. Remember what Jesus said to the apostles in Acts chapter 1:8. Jesus said to them, "You will be my witnesses." Where? He said, "In Jerusalem, and in Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." The disciples, when they heard this, I'm almost sure that they would feel the weight that God has called them to the world. He gave them a mandate that they could not do on their own. They needed power to do it. Like the disciples, we have work to do here. Again, we may not go overseas, but the world starts where our toes end. You and I have this same mandate to impact the world, and we start right here in Wake County. So I want to encourage each of us not to think of discipleship or disciple making merely individually. Because we do think individually, like, "I got to do this." Yes. But Jesus came and he is building his church. We must also think of this collectively. So when we evangelize and we make disciples, we need to understand that we are inviting people into something. We are inviting them into God's mission. His mission. But there's also a challenge with making disciples. We are challenging people to change. Change. Now that we have been saved, those of us in Christ, we have a new ambition. Now, again, I know where we live, and again, many of us probably already started making New Year's resolutions, right? Many of you, if you're like me, you got a resolution to shave off some pounds. I hadn't even started. But we have these resolutions. We have these ambitions, right? Things that we want to do. But is God's ambition at the center of what you want? What is his ambition? Habakkuk 2:14 says, "For the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord's glory as the waters cover the sea." When God looks at this world, he wants a world in which his glory would saturate all of it. North, south, east, and west. That his glory would saturate this world. So our main point, the thing I want us to understand, is that God's plan is to saturate the earth with his glory, and he uses his people, the church. Think of all of the ambitions and the platforms that people have that make it to the ends of the earth. I'm not going to talk about one over the other, but you got political parties that they want their agenda to go forward. Even nonprofit organizations like Black Lives Matter and other organizations, they want that to permeate the entire world. And oftentimes these secondary issues will become preeminent in our lives, and we want to push that agenda. But when it comes to making disciples, is God's agenda preeminent and primary for you? Is that the agenda that you and I understand that we must put forward? This is what it means to make disciples. And we do this through evangelizing, through making disciples, and also through church planting. So as we talk about this, there's three points that I just want to extract from Matthew 28. 18 through 20. The first thing, and I'm going to alliterate, and I don't ever alliterate, and I'm going to alliterate without P's. Matthew 28, 18, I want us to see the power of Jesus. The power of Jesus. Matthew 28, 19, I want us to see the program of Jesus. The program of Jesus. And in Matthew 28 and 20, I want us to see the presence of Jesus. So let's look at the first point, the power of Jesus, verse 18. Again, the text says, Jesus came near and said to them, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth." In his earthly life, Jesus had a very different state than he would have once he was raised from the dead. Again, we must understand, and I know we say this, that Jesus was fully man, but what does this mean? Jesus came to earth and he was tired. He went to sleep. He cried. He got frustrated. All of the things that you and I feel, Jesus felt in his humanity. He came to earth, but one thing that he did that you and I will not and cannot do is he lived a perfect life. He was sinless. And in his earthly life, he called some men to come and follow him. These men, when they followed Jesus, they saw everything that he did. They saw how Jesus ate. They heard him teach. They saw when he got frustrated with the religious elite, or when he would cry when he was at the tomb of Lazarus. They saw all of this. Jesus, when he would call the disciples, he would call his early disciples in an area called the Triangle, in around the Sea of Galilee. And the Triangle is made up of three cities: Bethsaida, Chorazin, and Capernaum. This area, we see he called the early disciples Peter, Andrew, James, and John. Now, what I love about this calling is that Jesus found them just doing work. Just normal guys. They're fishing. They're not doing anything grandiose. They're out there just trying to make a living. Just normal. And Jesus goes to these young men, and he looks them in the eyes, and he says, not asks, not put anything before them like, do you want to? He says, follow me. And the text says they left everything, their livelihood, and they followed him. But what does it mean when Jesus says, follow me? It means that Jesus called them to learn from him and also see him as the guiding priority in their lives. What's true for those 12 is also true for us. Is Jesus the guiding priority in our lives? Again, if we read other places in the Gospels, Jesus would call people to follow him, and then people will come up with excuses. Have you ever given an excuse to do what you know Jesus has called you to do? Okay, y'all good. I know I do it. Jesus called these folks to come follow him. One would say, you know what? I got to go bury my family. I can't do it, Jesus. You know what? Jesus, I got this business to attend to. You know, I just started a business and I'm trying to see it grow. But Jesus says, come follow me. I'm the guiding priority in your life. The disciples, when Jesus called those early disciples, the text says they immediately left everything and followed him. Again, they laid their livelihood down. Because I'm sure they could probably make some good money fishing. They let it go. As a matter of fact, when it talks about James and John, it says they left fishing and their father. And they went and they started following Jesus. What is it about Jesus that makes me let everything go to follow him? Even when it may not put no more money in my pocket. It may not give me status. I may not be at the top of the social rung. But because it's you, Jesus, I want to follow. So the disciples followed Jesus for 3 years. They saw all of his work. They saw him die and then raised from the dead. Now in his risen state, he has a new status. Because in verse 18 it says, he says, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Authority, this is the Greek word exousia. And this means that Jesus alone has the right to act in heaven and on earth. He alone has the right to act. The limitations that apply to his incarnation no longer apply to him in his risen state. I need to say this because I wonder if sometimes we doubt that in the midst of this pandemic that he still has authority. This pandemic is sweeping the globe. Jesus, you could stop it. And we may say, because you're not stopping it, maybe you don't have all the power. My Bible says he has authority not only in heaven, but also on earth. Not some authority, but all authority. All of it. God bestowed universal authority upon Jesus. And then Jesus passes this authority on to the disciples, and it passed on to his community, the church. Colossians 1:18 says, he is also the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. In the letter that Paul wrote to the church at Ephesus, the book of Ephesians, he would let the church know that Jesus is God's instrument of reconciliation in the world, and now the church is also Jesus' instrument of reconciliation in the world. This is because of Christ's authority. And now he uses you and I to be instruments to impact this world. His words have weight, power, and when he tells us to do something, because of his authority, we act on it. I've mentioned a few times that there have been in my life a lot of voices that have meant a lot. And when they spoke, I moved. I mean, obviously, it's my mom. She was the primary one that raised us, along with my grandmother and my grandfather. I also had coaches because I was an athlete. When the coaches told you to go run suicides, you didn't say, I don't feel like it. You just got down and you did it. But there was another voice that, as I get old, I reflect on how powerful her voice was in my life, and her name was Clara Roberts. It's my great-grandmother, born in 1906, not very educated by our educational standards, but she was brilliant. She stood all of about 4'10", long, beautiful hair. Now, somebody that short, with pretty hair, you would think they were soft-spoken. When she spoke, though, the earth moved. You didn't ask questions. When she told you to do something, oh, you did it. And she was one of the strongest people I have ever known in my life. So every summer, when I was young, we used to go what we would say up the country. Now, I don't know what y'all say here in North Carolina. We called it, when we were going to rural areas, we going up the country. My great-grandmother lived on land that she farmed. First time I ever saw a meat locker, chicken coop, you know, all that stuff. Like, I saw all of that growing up. And every summer, we would have to go up here to go and harvest what she had planted. Now, when I was born, she was about 70, right before 70. And now she is getting close to 80, and she's still out there working in the fields, and I used to hate it. Oh, my goodness. It's the summer. Alabama summers, if y'all know anything about the humidity, and so you say it's humid here. I can take you to a place that it will choke you. And so we get out in the fields, okra for rolls, potatoes, corn. We had to go get it all. And we had what was called a hamper that you'll get it in. Me and my brother, we throwing dirt bombs at each other, and we had to go out there and get it. But before we would get out there, because we would get out there before the sun came up, my great-grandmother had these feather beds that I know went back to the mid-1800s. I know it. Everything in the house was just old. We would lay in the beds, and you know, those feather beds, you know, we got the sleep number beds, and you got all these other kind of stuff where you just move around in it. Not in these. You get in them, you stuck. Now, my great-grandmother used to get up while dark, and the room that we stayed in was right off the kitchen. She would fix breakfast, lunch, and dinner before anyone got up. Anyone. But what used to cause us to move is we started smelling bacon, eggs frying. Not these biscuits that you get out the can. No. These are biscuits made from scratch. Hallelujah. Grits. I mean, you start smelling them. And so when you start smelling this food, what did you want to do? You want to get up, and it's time to eat, but we couldn't move because of the mama, as we used to call her, specifically stated that you could not move until I tell you you could move. Her voice was important. And what she said, we did. But there is a voice now that moves me even more emphatically than her voice did. And that's the voice of God that's presented in his word. We would obey our parents. They give us a command. But we treat God like it's just like, take it or leave it. When he has given us commands in his word. I feel like we come to this section in Matthew 28, actually verses 16 to 20, that scholars would call this the Great Commission. And we treat his Great Commission like it's a great suggestion. I'll do it, but I'm just concerned more about my family. And realizing, yes, God has given us families. That if you have a family, that yes, we're concerned about. But God did not just call us. He did not just call me to Latoya, Bria, and Zion. Yes, he called me to them, but he's also called me to many others. He's called me to many others. And I'm called to obey this. Why? Because Jesus has all authority. I know also when I look at my family, my children, and for those of us who do have children, praise God, I know we need to steward that well. And I would challenge us to do this. I think as parents, we need to look at our children as potential people that can change the world for the gospel. Can we see in them world changers for the sake of the gospel and parent them in that way? So the power of Jesus. Next, I want to see the program of Jesus. In verse 19, it says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." Now that Jesus has all authority in the text, he now commissions them to go and make disciples of all nations. We read nations, and I want us to read all ethnic groups. Right? Jesus did not limit his call for us to be around folks that look like us. He called us to go into spaces of people with different ethnicities from us. go and make disciples of all nations. Now, prior to this, Jesus told the disciples not to go to the Gentiles. See, don't go to them, but go only to the nation of Israel. Now he says, go therefore and make disciples of all nations. Now, the New Testament was written originally in a language called Greek, and the verb, the main verb in this passage is not go, it is not baptize, it is not teach. The main verb in this passage is make disciples. But what does this mean? This means to turn someone into a disciple. Now we have to ask, what is a disciple? A disciple is a learner and a follower of Jesus, wholeheartedly committed to him. Again, we said earlier, one who makes Jesus a priority, the central priority in our lives. This is a command for people to change. Now, if we study what is it in their culture, what it meant to be a disciple, disciples followed a rabbi because they wanted to become what he is. It's no different from the 12 with Jesus, because Jesus would say in Luke chapter 6:40, a disciple is not above his teacher, but everyone who is fully trained will be like his teacher. Again, following Jesus was not merely an intellectual academic exercise. I'm talking to a lot of those of us who love information. Again, if you're like me, you just got books overflowing. We have information all before us. But following Jesus is not an exercise in how much more information I know. And we're going to see that a little bit later. This is about becoming what he is. Now that Jesus has paid the price for sins and was raised from the dead, he is going back to the Father. You can see how the disciples felt in John chapters 14 through 16. He's on his way back to the Father, but he's leaving the disciples here. They have work to do. There is a worldwide scope to their mission, Acts 1:8. Now, when you read the book of Acts, you would see that the church and the people had a rough time early on obeying Jesus by going to the ends of the earth. They just wanted to huddle in and around Jerusalem. Isn't it easier for us to just be around people who look like us and act like us and talk like us and think like us? Isn't that easier? Like, we can just throw some stuff out there. Like, I can go back to my old neighborhood and throw out all kind of inner city jargon and won't have to decipher that for nobody. But God has called me to something so much greater. It's easy for me to be around other people who are African American. It's easier for me to do that. But God did not call me to that. He did not call any of us to just be around folks who are just like us. In the book of Acts, Jesus said to them that you will be my witnesses, not only in Jerusalem, but in Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So they huddled around Jerusalem among other Jews, and then God did something. He hurled a persecution. Or, based on whatever your theological construct, he allowed it. But persecution happened. What then took place? The people of God scattered. But this is what happened when they scattered. They went opening their mouths. They went opening their mouths. And other people heard. Antioch. And we know when Paul came on the scene, his whole mission was to take this gospel to places that have never heard this gospel. Persecution didn't stop the gospel from growing among God's people. And it won't stop in our day. The gospel will always bear fruit. This has always been God's heart. To gather people from every ethnic group, different communities around the world, to be a part of his people. People from all ethnic groups. I love what the scholar Vince Bontu pointed out in one of his writings. He said this. He said, since ethnicity is more than just a group of people, but also shared systems of beliefs governing social interaction, then the call of Jesus is not simply to make disciples of people, but also of ethnic and cultural systems. Our cultural, racial, and ethnic identities must be discipled and formed into the image of God. All that we are must be discipled into what Jesus wants us to look like. And then we are called to then go into these spaces among people who may be of different ethnic groups and make disciples of them also. In this verse, Jesus told them to make disciples of all nations by going and baptizing. In other words, the normal rhythms of life. As you are going, make disciples. And when a believer is baptized, this believer is then placed in the body of Christ by the Holy Spirit into a community of believers. And they are placed in this community. Baptism places a people into a community where they will be able to hear the word of God proclaimed. Baptism is not something magical. It's a mark like circumcision that places you within the community of faith where you will hear God's word proclaimed. This is how Jesus has determined to reach the world by making disciples. And this is not easy work, it's hard work. Many of us have been on cruises. Y'all know what a cruise is? A cruise is a spot where if you are a passenger, you get what you want, when you want, how you want it, whenever you want it. I'm hungry. I want me a steak. I want some ice cream. I want to go upstairs and play shuffleboard. I still don't know what shuffleboard is, really. But I want to do what I want to do on this cruise ship. I've taken a cruise. I don't have to do another one. I think my wife and I are on the same page with that. Yeah, I'm good with it. Right now, especially with this Rona going around. But cruise ships are markedly different from battleships. So on a cruise ship, on a battleship, you can't wait for somebody to come and serve you. Because every person on a battleship, from the top guy or lady to the lowest guy or lady, everyone on that ship is preparing for battle. We're preparing for war. So everyone has a role to do, and everyone's role is vital. You can't just lay up in your cabin and say, you know what, they got it today. I'm not worried about it. They're going to serve me. No. Everyone on a battleship is given tools to be ready for when it goes down. I know my role. In the church today, sometimes I feel like we have a cruise ship feel. We come in, and I don't say this beratingly or to belittle anyone, but we come in and I'm even a culprit of this, because I put some things in place to make sure that these things happen to serve, and I want to serve you. But if we have the attitude that, you know what, I'm going to be a passive listener and I'm just coming to get. Everything I want, this church is giving me. And if they're not giving me all the things I want, then I'm going to go find another church. That's cruise ship mentality. Battleship mentality says, where are the spaces they need me to serve? Look at my giftings. I'm all in. Even if the music is not good, even if the preaching is not up to par, and it may not be a lot of people in the church, but I'm coming to bring who I am. Because we're preparing for battle. We're in the midst of a spiritual battle. And there are many scriptures that show us that we're in the midst of a spiritual battle. Listen to Matthew chapter 16, verses 16 and 17. Jesus said, "Blessed are you, Simon of Jonah, son of Jonah, because flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overpower it." Battle language. Ephesians 6, verses 11 and 12, Paul says, "Put on the full armor of God so that you can stand against the schemes of the devil. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this darkness, against evil spiritual forces in the heavens." Battle language. And then in Revelation 19, John would write, "Then I saw heaven open, and there was a white horse. Its rider is called Faithful and True, and he judges and makes war with justice." Then in verses 14 and 16, it says, "The armies that were in heaven followed him on white horses, wearing pure white linen. A sharp sword came from his mouth so that he might strike the nations with it. He will rule them with an iron rod. He will also trample the winepress of the fierce anger of God, the Almighty, and he has a name written on his robe and on his thigh, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, battle language. What I'm thankful about when it comes to the church is that the church is an outpost of resistance against the enemy. Churches exist on the battlefield. Since the church is a people, God's people are involved in spiritual warfare, but it's not pretty. It is not pretty. But I can attest, though, that we know how this ends, though, right? Revelation shows us how this ends. Jesus wins. And there is a sweetness to coming into a battle, even though I'm the weakest, or our, you know, just the church, whatever that may be, made up of people who are weak, that Jesus got this covered. We win. Therefore, we can be about his mission. So let me ask you, friends, how are you being about God's business in every area of your life? How are you reproducing yourself in the lives of others spiritually? Is this something that you're intentionally doing? Not that you got to have a book and walk through a book with someone, even though that's good, but how are you intentionally investing your life into the life of someone else to see them go from not only spiritual death to spiritual life, but also spiritual infancy to spiritual maturity? And then challenging them to do the same with others that you did with them. Finally, I want us to see the presence of Jesus in verse 20. It says, teaching them to observe everything I have commanded you, and remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. The mission of Jesus requires us to teach new disciples to observe or obey all that Jesus commanded. Baptism is not the end-all be-all, even though baptism is vitally important. The church must also teach. Teach what? Teach everything that Jesus commanded. This is not about having information for information's sake. Most of us have a lot of information and education already. But this observing is an observing that speaks of obeying what Jesus commanded in every area of life. So as I am loving my neighbor, how am I embodying this aspect of obeying all that Jesus commanded? Even when I step into spaces of justice, as I care for the poor, as a husband, as you love your wives, as the Bible would say, respect your husband, loving him as well, obeying him in every area of life. If you're single, what does it look like for you now to obey all that Jesus commanded in your singleness? What Jesus taught is not simply about getting into heaven. What he taught impacts us right here where we live. He cares about the words I speak. He cares about the thoughts I think. He cares about the actions I do. Teach everything I have commanded. What I love about when he says this is that you and I do not have the luxury of cherry picking what we want to teach in Scripture. We got our favorite verses, then we go to that same verse and we teach that, and it's good. We teach all that, but that's why I love teaching verse by verse through books, because I can't now jump away from, oh, it's telling that's uncomfortable, or that's weird. How do I teach that? I step into it. Teach everything I have commanded. Then Jesus said to the disciples, and remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. This is a statement of assurance. What I love about this statement, he does not say, I will be with you. He says, I am with you. We have the assurance that we will not be left alone to serve God. We have a great companion who will help us fulfill the Great Commission. He is with us wherever we are. This Great Commission is how we reach the world. It's how we reach the world. We must know that the message of the kingdom that Jesus gave and that we proclaim is going to bear an incredible harvest. This is what I love. The true church that Jesus died for, that he is building, it's no problem. It's growing. The church that Jesus died for, it is growing. Now, we got statistics in our world that says the church is declining. I get it, but I know what Jesus said, and I trust that that church is growing. Different people of different ethnicities and different cultures coming to know who he is. And because of this, we can be encouraged to go out and spread the word with him. And I pray that as we do it, we will have the vision that he has for the world. I heard a story about three bricklayers. One bricklayer saw his work as simply laying bricks. This is not an easy job, but my job is just to lay bricks. That was the right vision, but it was a very low vision. Then the second guy saw himself in bricklaying as building a wall with the bricks. That's a better vision, but it's still, it's not quite there. But the third guy in laying bricks, he had a greater vision. He saw that in his work of laying bricks, he was building a grand cathedral. You see the difference in their vision. Friends, what vision do we have in this work? Do we just see it as, oh man, y'all share my faith because this person may get saved? That's great. But what about this greater vision? That God is using you and I to be change agents in the world, that what I'm doing here will impact people in Zimbabwe. And the kingdom of God is expanding. Will we have that vision? So as you hear this, my friends, are you in the story or simply just hearing the story? Are you treating this scripture as just a story like, man, that's good? You know how we watch a movie? We just pass it like, oh man, that's good. That's good acting. Or do you look at the scripture and say, where am I in this story? How am I to respond? I hope that you would think the latter. Because if you say that you are a follower of Jesus Christ, you have this mandate. I have this mandate to go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe or obey everything I have commanded. And then Jesus gives this assurance, I am with you always to the end of the age. Let's pray. Lord God, I thank you for the truth of your word. I thank you also that your word declares that it will not return void. You do not utter words that have no power and that will not accomplish what you sent it out to do. So Lord God, as we continue to think through what it means to make disciples of all nations, I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would empower us to be about your work every day of our lives, in every sphere of our lives, that you would get the glory. I pray that there will be people who are far from you right now that will come to know you because of our obedience in going out, sharing our faith, and making disciples. Lord, impact this world through the way that you use us right here in Wake County. So, Lord, I thank you and I bless you. It's in Christ's name I do ask this. Amen. So, friends, we are going to continue to sing to the Lord, but let's turn our attention now to the Lord's Supper, remembering the work of Jesus. And I will point to, and you can look at, in your worship guide or on the screen, the words printed, I'll begin. Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of of me. For as often as we eat this bread and drink the cup, we proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Come receive this bread and wine and remember that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Instead of coming, the pre-practiced elements are under your seats. If you happen to be here today and you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, first of all, I am thankful that you are here. I'm thankful, but I would ask that you not partake of the elements or partake of communion at this time. But if you want to know what it means to follow Jesus, I would invite you to come and talk with me and let's walk through what it means to trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. But for those of us who are in Christ, family is an opportunity for us to eat together. So right now, partake, remembering the body of the Lord Jesus Christ broken and his blood shed.
Put your hands together with us up here.
Fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Have a wonderful evening. Go in peace.
Everybody say, I am not forgotten. I am not forgotten. I am not forgotten. God knows my name. I am not forgotten. I am not forgotten. I am not forgotten. God knows my name. He knows my name.
He knows my name.
Darkness, strength of a weakness, joy. misunderstandings. He knows my name. Father to the fatherless, friend to the friendless, joy to the hopeless. He knows my name. Oh.